Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents At Home in the Dark. Edited by Lawrence Block. Narrated by Peter Berkrot and Teri Schnaubelt. It's getting dark in here. A foreword by Lawrence Block. Ages ago, Lucille Ball had this exchange on I Love Lucy with a snobbish character whose task it was to elevate her culturally. Snob. Now, there are two words I never want to hear you say. One is swell, and the other is lousy. Lucy. Okay, let's start with the lousy one. Funny what lingers in the mind. Every year or so, I stub my toe on a couple of buzzwords and decide I'd just as soon not encounter them again. There are two that I've found increasingly annoying of late, and if Lucy were here, I'd tell her that one of them is awesome and the other is iconic. It is in the nature of the spoken language for words to come and go, and none are more cyclical than those we choose to indicate strong approval or disapproval. Swonderful, Cole Porter told us, that you should care for me. Indeed, smarvelous, isn't it? Wonderful, marvelous, terrific, sensational, excellent, brilliant. Each takes its turn as a way of demonstrating great positive enthusiasm. For quite a few years now, le mot du jour has been awesome. Now, it's a perfectly reasonable word, and means simply that the noun thus modified is likely to inspire awe, even as that which is wonderful is clearly full of wonder. If everything thus described is truly awesome, one is left to contemplate a generation of wide-eyed and slack-jawed folk gaping at all that is arrayed in front of them. Well, okay. Periodically, a word of approval swims upstream into the zeitgeist, resonates with enough of us to have an impact, and becomes the default term for us all, or at least those of us under 40. Before too long, its original meaning has been entirely subsumed, and all it means to call something awesome is that one likes it. Deep down where it lives, awesome is essentially identical in meaning to awful. And there was a time when awful and wonderful were synonyms, full of awe, full of wonder. Now, as Lucy could tell you, one is swell and the other is lousy. If anything good is awesome, then anything memorable or distinctive is iconic. I shouldn't complain, I don't suppose, as several of my own books have had that label applied to them. And perhaps I ought to regard the whole business as awesome. But iconic? Really? No narcissist thinks more highly of his own work than I. But I have trouble picturing any of my books as literal icon, displayed on the wall of a Russian Orthodox cathedral. Wait, let me rethink that. Maybe 8 million Ways to Die might make the cut. I mean, dude, that book is awesome. Never mind. I have the honor to present to you 17 stories, any or all of which you might well describe as awesome or iconic, or both. And I want to introduce them by pointing out another buzzword, of one of which I've tired at least as much as I have of the two of them combined. Noir. It's a perfectly good word, and particularly useful if you're in Paris and an ominous feline crosses your path. Un chat noir, you might say, or you might offer a Gallic shrug and pretend you hadn't seen it. Noir is the French word for black. But when it makes its way across la mer, it manages to gain something in translation. Early on, it became attached to a certain type of motion picture. A French critic named Nino Frank coined the term film noir in 1946, but it took a couple of decades for the phrase to get any traction. I could tell you what does and doesn't constitute classic film noir, and natter on about its visual style, with roots in German expressionist cinematography, But you can check out Wikipedia as well as I can. That, after all, is what I did, and how I happen to know about Nino Frank. Or you can read a recent novel of mine, The Girl with the Deep Blue Eyes. The protagonist, an ex-NYPD cop turned Florida private eye, is addicted to the cinematic genre. When he's not acting out a role in his own real-life film noir, he's on the couch with his feet up, watching how Hollywood used to do it. That's what the French word for black is doing in the English language. It's modifying the word film and describes a specific example thereof. Now, though, it's all over the place. The credit, or the blame if you prefer, goes to Johnny Temple of Akashic Books. In 2004, Akashic published Brooklyn Noir, Tim McLaughlin's anthology of original crime stories set in that borough. They did very well with it, well enough to prompt McLaughlin to compile and Akashic to publish a sequel, Brooklyn Noir 2, The Classics, consisting of reprint. It did well too, and a lot of publishers would have let it go at that. But Akashic went on to publish a whole cottage industry of darkness. A look at the publisher's website shows a total of 120 published and forthcoming noir titles, but the number is sure to be higher by the time you read this. Akashic clearly subscribes to the notion that every city has a dark side and deserves a chance to tell its own stories. It is, I must say, a wholly estimable enterprise. I could not begin to estimate the number of writers whose first appearance in print has come in an Akashic anthology. They owe Akashic a debt of gratitude, as does a whole world of readers. And as do I. I had the pleasure of editing Manhattan Noir and Manhattan Noir 2, and while neither brought me wealth beyond the dreams of avarice, each was a source of personal and artistic satisfaction. And, after I'd coaxed a couple of friends into writing stories for my anthology, I could hardly demur when they turned the tables on me. I'd written one myself for Manhattan Noir, and wrote another for S.J. Rosan's Bronx Noir, and a third for Sarah Cortez and Bootsy Martinez's Indian Country Noir. All three were about the same cheerfully homicidal young woman, and although she didn't yet have a name, she clearly had a purpose in life. I found more stories to write about her, realized they were chapters of a novel in progress, and in time, Getting Off was published by Hard Case Crime. So I wish their series continued success. Although their stories have never had much to do with Hollywood's 1940 version of noir, neither are they happy little tales full of kitty cats and bunny rabbits. They are serious stories, taking in the main a hard line on reality, and any grayscale would show them on the dark end of the spectrum. Noir? Noirish? Okay, fine. I'm happy for them to go on using the word. In fact, I'm all for letting them trademark it, just so the rest of the world could quit using it. That, gentle reader, is a rant. And you can relax now. I'm done with it. So, here we have 17 stories, and you'll note that they cover a lot of ground in terms of genre. Most are crime fiction to a greater or lesser degree. But James Reasoner's is a period western, and Joe Hill's is horror, and Joe R. Lansdale's is set in a dystopian future. And what they all have in common, besides their unquestionable excellence, is where they stand on that gray scale. They are, in a word, dark. And that, I must confess, is the modifier I greatly prefer to noir. It's easy to see I'm partial to it. A few years ago, I put together a collection of New York stories for Three Rooms Press, and the title I fastened upon was Dark City Lights. While I was at it, I fastened as well upon some of that book's contributors. Of the writers in At Home in the Dark, six of them, Ed Park, Jim Fusilli, Thomas Pluck, Jill D. Blanc, Elaine Kagan, and Warren Moore, wrote stories for Dark City Lights. The title came to me early on. Years ago, I'd come across O. Henry's last words, spoken on his deathbed, And in case you missed them in the epigraph, you needn't flip pages. "Turn up the lights," said the master of the surprise ending. "I don't want to go home in the dark." I can but hope you enjoy At Home in the Dark. I find it's inspired me, and there's another anthology taking shape in my mind even now. I already have a title in mind, and it's 5 words long, as my titles tend to be, and it has the word dark in it. Trust me, it'll be awesome.
Hot Pants by Elaine Kagan. "Dad," Lucinda said. Her father was snoring, relaxed and long in a faded chintz wing chair, legs out in front of him, ankles crossed, size 13 feet and thick white socks on a matching faded chintz ottoman. The chair was permanently placed in front of a large TV screen that was permanently tuned to Turner Classic Movies. The movie playing that morning was something in black and white with Jimmy Cagney, or maybe it was Mickey Rooney, she wasn't sure which, tapping around a giant movie set that was supposed to look like a street in downtown Manhattan. The guy could really dance. People shuffled in and out to the long living room. The sound was turned way down on the TV, and most of the people pushing their walkers across the ratty rug were silent and smiling. Some sat motionless, like kids playing dead, jaws dropped, heads thrown back, eyes closed. Like zombies, Lucinda thought. 12 white zombies being herded around a big rambling two-story house by 2 brown women, 1 brown man, 1 black woman and 2 black men, rotating hours and days in blue scrubs in Newark, New Jersey. Mrs. Ventimiglia sat at the piano, her hands folded and quiet in her lap. She never played, and it wasn't clear if she was looking at the sheet music on the piano table or out the window. Her daughter said she'd been a really terrific jazz pianist. Very Bill Evans, her daughter said. Lucinda had to look up Bill Evans. Mrs. Ventimiglia had also been a reporter for the New York Post, and it was ironic that Mr. Santangelo, who spent most of his time on the cracked leather sofa across from the fireplace that had no logs, was reading a yellowed copy of the New York Post that he carried around in his pocket. It didn't seem to matter that the news wasn't current. Lucinda didn't know if Mrs. Ventimiglia and Mr. Santangelo had ever even spoken. Mr. Santangelo was in pretty good shape, except for every now and then when he had a screaming fit and threw things. No one so far had figured out what set him off. "He's nuts," her father said. Lucinda leaned forward, her face closer to her father's. "Daddy?" His feet jumped a little, and the snoring stopped with an abrupt intake of breath, as if he'd stopped breathing altogether for maybe 20 seconds, and then started up again, like a car engine. Not as loud, but still strong. He was still strong, her father. His mind was full of smoke, as he frequently pointed out with a wry laugh when he was in, as he put it, but his body betrayed his 68 years. He looked maybe 58 tops. He had a character actor face with dark red wavy hair and a solid muscular build. No gut above his belt. He had a splatter of freckles across ruddy cheeks, a thick neck, and thick hands. He could probably still jump on and off a fire engine, pull a hose, climb a ladder, chainsaw through a roof, or run into flames looking like the picture poster of how a fire captain should look. Although he just might not be able to remember what a fire engine did, or a hose or a ladder or a chainsaw, or how to brush his teeth, or cut his meat, or recognize Chief Lang when he came to visit. "I know this guy, right?" he said to Lucinda, tilting his head towards the fire chief. Chief Archie Lang and her father had gone through the academy together, had been best men at each other's weddings, and were godfathers to each other's kids. "I'm losing me," her father said in a gruff whisper to Archie Lang, leaning in close and secret. "Don't tell the kid, okay?" "Okay," Chief Lang said, giving a brave nod to Lucinda and an affectionate punch to her dad's upper arm. Lucinda made a concerted effort to not die right there or throw up. He was in and out now, this stalwart father of hers, slipping down the ladder of dementia. Hello. Lucinda looked up. A tiny, wiry woman wearing a print dress with pink socks stuffed into white open-toed house slippers was standing right next to the arm of her chair. She had several strands of beads slung around her neck, hot pink lipstick with blush to match, and she was pushing 90. Hello, Mrs. Moskowitz. Hello, yourself. She looked hard at Lucinda. Do you know this man? Yes, ma'am, Lucinda said. He's my father. Uh-huh. Is he Jewish? Lucinda smiled and shook her head. He's Italian, Mrs. Moskowitz. They'd had this same conversation maybe 4 times that morning, and maybe 27 times in the last month. He doesn't look Italian. Right, Lucinda said, studying her father. He actually looks Irish. Mrs. Moskowitz sighed. I had an Italian man once, she said, lowering her voice and giving Lucinda a woman-to-woman stare. He was a no-good Nick, if you know what I mean. I do. Well then, she said, pushing her walker forward. I have to get home, she said. My mother will kill me. It's a school night, you know. Okay, Lucinda said. Jesus, Mary, and Joseph. She touched her father's arm, kind of jostled him. Dad, I have to go to work. Nicholas John Conte coughed, cleared his throat, and opened his eyes. Clear blue, nothing dimmed in the sight area. He stretched a giant's stretch, folding his arms over his face and then extending them out to the sides, spreading his fingers, lifting his legs straight out in front of him, pointing his toes and flexing, and then down again with the appropriate sounds of a big man stretching. Hey, Lucy, he said, smiling up at his daughter. Well, you had a good nap?
I wasn't asleep,
she laughed. You weren't?
Just checking the inside of my eyelids, he said and yawned.
He'd been saying that since she could remember. He looked around the room.
Where's your mother?
Dad, Mom hasn't been here for years, you know that. He took maybe a minute to ponder it.
Oh, right, the guy with the boat.
Right.
Who knew she liked boats?
He said and laughed. He looked around the room.
And here I am at the big house.
Dad,
when will my house be ready?
Soon. This was his new thing, fixing it in his head that his house was being worked on, plumbing, paint, new floors, etc. He'd tell you. It was Lucinda's choice to let him believe it. The first few months had been endless battles about him getting out of there.
What the hell is going on here, Lucy? He would shout. Am I a goddamn prisoner?
It came to a near brawl one night with Miguel and Reginald, two of the attendants at the home. It was Reverend Father King's idea to tell him the house was under construction.
You want me to lie, Father?
It's not a lie if you paint the kitchen, Lucinda, he said, leaning back in his chair.
So much for being Catholic.
Damn construction guys, Nick Conte muttered. This always happens, you know. I told you. We'll be done by February. We'll be done by March. Where's the peanut?
In school. I gotta go to work, Dad.
Oh, right. Sure, kid,
he said, pulling his feet back and off the ottoman, stuffing them into his loafers, fixing the front of his shirt, running his hand through his hair and standing up.
How is everything?
Good, she said, slipping on her jacket, shrugging her handbag strap over her shoulder and pulling the car keys from her jeans pocket.
Everything good at the restaurant?
Yep.
They make great creamed spinach. It's the nutmeg, you know. That's the ticket.
I know. He put his hand on her shoulder, steering her to the front door.
Did you bring me my lasagna?
Yes, sir. I gave it to Princess. You saw when I got here.
Right. That's your grandmother's recipe, you know.
I know.
Old man Sorrentino had sticky fingers. He could steal your grandma's rosary beads right out of her hand. You know that, right?
She laughed. We'll go Sunday.
Good idea. With the peanut.
She took her father and her 6-year-old daughter Maria to the restaurant every Sunday,
Every single Sunday since she'd moved him into this wretched place that cost her a small fortune and was supposedly one of the best group houses for people with dementia in all of New Jersey, not just in Belleville or Bloomfield, a big old house smelling faintly of old carpet and pine sole and burnt onions and Mrs. Moskowitz's jungle gardenia and someone's adult pamper and bad breath and wet dog, which was ridiculous because there was no dog allowed on the premises, not even to visit, which made no sense because it was a known fact that animals helped people with stress, and there was enough stress in this place to choke a horse, her mother would have said. Her beautiful mother, who had walked out on them when Lucinda was 15, for a cop named Vinny, who worked in Brooklyn, and it was hard to say which was worse, a firefighter's wife leaving him for a cop, or the fact that the cop was from Brooklyn. Not even counting the boat. Vinny had a Chris Craft cabin cruiser, or a Chris Cross cabin cruiser, she wasn't sure which, but it seemed to matter a great deal to her mother.
She likes the pudding.
Who?
The peanut. She likes the pudding at Serendipity's.
Sorrentino's dad.
At Sorrentino's, right.
And it's budino, not pudding. He shrugged.
Budino, pudding, what the hell's the difference?
Lucinda rested her forehead against the steering wheel. It was icy. All of New Jersey was icy. The streets, the bare branches of the trees against the pale sky, her heart. She couldn't take care of him anymore. Not after the thing with the oven. Not after the thing with the car.
You can't take care of him anymore,
her Aunt Angie said with defiance, feet planted, arms crossed over her breasts.
It's enough. Soon he won't know how to wipe his own ass, she said.
Lucinda's mouth opened.
I can say that. He's my brother, Angie said. What if he takes Maria in the car with him? What if he takes her to Bloomfield Center and loses her, or drives to Philadelphia?
Lucinda actually smiled. Why would Dad go to Philadelphia?
Oh, I don't know,
Angie said, collapsing into a chair, sobbing.
Jesus, Mary and Joseph, my Nicky, what a thing.
It's a good place, Reverend Father King said about the home. It's enough, Lucinda. This is a good place.
She started the car.
¿Cómo está, Lucy?
Jose shouted over the din as she walked into Sorrentino's crowded kitchen. Cooks and waiters, busboys and dishwashers jostled for position at sink and stove and counters, moving pots and pans and plates and food with the precision of the New York Yankees, or possibly the New York City Ballet Company. She wasn't sure which. And in the middle of the whole commotion stood Jose, stacking thick white plates on trays. Jose Conchola had been a busboy at Sorrentino's since Lucinda had been coming there as a little girl. 60 now, he knew all the regulars and they all knew him, a fixture, as faithful as their recipe for lasagna.
I'm fine, she said. Good. How's the papa?
The same.
The same is good,
Enrique said, lifting his eyes from a mountain of tomatoes he was chopping.
You think?
I think, yes,
he said emphatically, waving the knife in his hand.
Change is fearful.
Enrique was proud of his English and liked to show off his extensive vocabulary, which wasn't always the use of the correct word at the correct time.
With studying, no one will know I am from Puerto Rico,
he would say, which brought down the house, or actually the kitchen.
They will all think you are from Norway,
Simon, one of the dishwashers, shouted, and everyone laughed. If you cooked in Sorrentino's kitchen, you spoke Spanish. Mexico, Puerto Rico, Guatemala, it didn't matter which country. You just couldn't work at Sorrentino's as a chef if you were Italian. It was a policy, a proclamation laid down years ago by the old man.
You hire an Italian to cook in your kitchen and they will change your recipe,
old man Sorrentino had said with disdain.
You hire a Mexican and they do exactly as you say.
The only Italian chef allowed to cook in that kitchen was Sorrentino's nephew, Salvatore, who had gone to the Cordon Bleu of Naples,
or whatever the hell was the equivalent, and then worked in Manhattan in two restaurants that were supposedly very la-di-da, but too expensive for Lucinda to try, not even counting trying to get into the city and to the Upper East Side. Enrique told her a plate of gnocchi was $36. He'd taken his wife and daughter for her confirmation.
A veal chop costs more than a cheap suit. That is the expression, yes?
Yes, Lucinda answered, laughing. Carlos, one of Sorrentino's sauté chefs, followed Salvatore around like a puppy, but it was Lucinda's take that the other guys in the kitchen thought Salvatore was full of himself. Chuchu, the grill chef, called him un perro or un cerdo behind his back, which was a dog or a pig, which exasperated Jose.
You should not be offending the animals.
Part of it was jealousy. After all, he had a real education and real experience. Although his gnocchi were not cloud pillows of perfection like Carlos made, and his veal chop in a balsamic glaze didn't get close to Chuchu's. We got a lot of reservations?
Only the old ones, Jose said, grinning. They come for the noon whistle, he said, smacking the swinging door with his hip and sailing out of the kitchen. Que miada this noon mediodía? Chuchu asked. Speak English, Enrique shouted.
It was not her intention to end up waiting tables and being pleasant to people who sent back their steak because this isn't rare, this is mooing, or eating cloud pillows of gnocchi way too late at night, which couldn't be good for her thighs, but was good for her purse and her peace of mind. She'd been in line for the general manager position at Armstrong's when they went out of business, in like 4 hours over some hush-hush crooked money transaction that stunk to high heaven, as her Aunt Angie put it, which happened the week after she'd put her father into the big house and Maria into Ridge Street School first grade. She'd been working at Armstrong's for 12 years, from right after she graduated, married Marty, got pregnant, had the peanut Maria, and Marty got sick and then sicker and actually died. Actually, because who dies when they're 36? A starker Jewish up-and-coming immigration lawyer who could dance like Jimmy Cagney or maybe Mickey Rooney and could actually sew a hem and tell jokes like a borscht belt comic and had basketball hands? Yes. So what the hell was she going to do with no job at Armstrong's? How was she going to pay for everything? She had to call Chief Lang to find out about her dad's pension and insurance. And that Sunday, they'd gone to Sorrentino's for early dinner, her dad and Maria and Angie. And like a gift from the gods, when Marco was cleaning off their table, he told her that Rosa had quit that morning with no notice, and the Sorrentino's were hysterical looking for someone. And Angie had come through for her like justify winning the Triple Crown at Belmont. I know how to babysit, she said to Lucinda, eyes narrowing, chin raised. I babysat you plenty, didn't I, after your mother ran off into the night? Lucinda smiled. It wasn't in the night, Ange. Ah, the age-old story of her mother running away with Vinny. It's a figure of speech, right? Did I step in and take care of you while your father spent days on that fire engine? Yes, ma'am, you did. Days, nights, all those hours, busting his ass? Yes, ma'am. So I'll step in again. What's the problem? Well, your time. I don't expect you to give up your life to take care of Maria for me while I'm hustling plates of red sauce. And what am I supposed to do with my time, missy? Dust? Play mahjong? Lucinda laughed. You don't play mahjong. Well, I could learn, Angie said. And because Etta and Bruno Sorrentino had known her practically since she'd been born, and she'd worked there 2 summers when she was in high school, and they needed somebody fast, since Rosa had up and quit with no notice, a betrayal, Bruno had said, his lips pulled into a thin line like a guy in The Godfather. And because they were more than fair about working out hours with her and the rest of the wait staff so she could see her dad and her kid, she made her peace with it. She bought 3 white blouses and 3 pairs of black slacks with black sneakers and learned how to tie the stupid black tie. After all, she didn't need to sing 3 verses of I Need This Job from a chorus line to know what was up. She would wait tables at Sorrentino's. The first time it happened was last fall, the lovely lull between lunch and dinner. Chuchu put his feet up,
Simon had a cigarette in the alley. They actually locked the front door from 3 to 5. They even turned off the wretched background music, which was barely audible when the restaurant was full, but could make your teeth hurt when you could hear it. Italian crooners from the old days. Which was okay every now and then, but not Night and Day, which was one of the songs that played over and over. And how many times could you listen to Julius La Rosa singing Ehi Compari? Bruno was not interested in new music or any of the new devices that could bring music into the restaurant. I am an old-fashioned man, Lucinda. This is an old-fashioned restaurant. Le capisce? I got it, she said. Don't make trouble with him, her Aunt Angie said. He'll have us all bumped off. Ange, you're hysterical. The Sorrentinos aren't in the mob.
What's a mob? Maria asked.
A group of people who are up to trouble, Angie answered. Who wants ice cream? It was so slight that she wasn't even sure it had happened. She was outside in back during the lull, maybe 4 o'clock, 4:30. It was everything you wanted an autumn afternoon to be, chill in the shade, warm in the dazzling sun, the leaves doing their red and gold thing. She was just standing there watching the sky, actually thinking about Marty running track at Rutgers, coming off the track and hugging her, all sweaty and laughing, and she was already all dressed up to go to this tea. I don't even like tea, she had said.
It's a big deal to get invited to tea at the Dean's, Marty said.
Why?
Because they're coffee drinkers.
You're all sweaty.
It's sexy, huh?
He said. She closed her eyes. The car hardly made any noise, Sal's wife's car. It slid up and he got out. If he leaned in to kiss Teri goodbye, Lucinda missed it. Teri gave a little wave and Lucinda gave a little wave and the car made a U and took off and Sal walked past her with a hey and she had a sweater draped over her shoulders and it had slipped off on one side and as he passed her, he kind of propped it back up on her shoulder and his hand barely slid a little down her arm and his fingers moved across her breast. Across her breast. Right? He went in Sorrentino's back door and she stood there. The second time was the same sort of thing, right before they unlocked the front door for dinner. The 5 o'clock whistle, Jose called it. She was tossing the hot half-sliced bread into the baskets. They sliced them halfway through so the people could pull them the rest of the way, letting off a tantalizing whiff of hot baked bread. Enrique had sliced the first batch of loaves and was on his way back to the oven. Salvatore was on his way to the stove holding a cupped handful of truffles, and as he slid behind her, he rubbed the front of his body against her ass. His cock was hard. It wasn't a narrow kitchen. It's not like he didn't have plenty of room to get around her. And it's not like she didn't remember what a hard cock felt like. Son of a bitch. She dropped the bread she was holding and whipped around to look at him, but he was already at the stove lecturing Chuchu on sautéing truffles. She stood there.
What's up, Lucy? Jose said.
Nothing. Her heart was racing. The third time, he'd actually cupped her ass. It was in the dining room after they'd closed, or at least weren't going to serve anyone else. There were always stragglers. There was a boisterous family falling all over each other, after many bottles of Montepulciano, struggling to make it to the door. And in the corner booth sat Mr. Ruben, with three cronies sipping Remy. Al Ruben was a regular. She wasn't exactly sure who he was, but she knew he was somebody. She wasn't exactly sure if people were still connected, but if they were, he was. She wasn't interested in knowing. She knew Jose held him in high regard. He always got in even if he didn't have a reservation, and when Salvatore had gone over to pay his respects, he'd practically genuflected in front of the table. It was on Sal's way back. Jose and Marco had picked up dirty dishes, glasses, and silverware, and were moving back into the kitchen, trays full. Lucinda bent over to get a tossed napkin they'd missed halfway hidden under the tablecloth, and as she bent to get it, he was behind her, cupping her ass. It must have looked as if he was helping her pick up whatever she was going for. His body must have blocked what he was doing with his hand, his fingers sliding to the middle of her ass and pushing. She practically fell getting back up, and he made a big deal of saying, "Scusi, scusi," and took off into the kitchen. She held the crumpled napkin to her chest. She steadied herself. She walked slowly after him. Simon and Pepe were washing pots and singing. Jose and Marco were laughing. Chuchu was on his cell phone. There was no sign of Salvatore, who must have been in the little closet office down the hall. The door was open. He was sitting at the desk, scribbling something on a piece of paper. "What are you doing?" she said.
"I write tomorrow's specials. I think the vongole with tomatoes."
She took a breath. "No, what are you doing with me?"
"What am I doing with you?"
She was clutching the doorframe. "With me. You had your hand on me."
"What?"
"Don't what. You had your hand on my ass." He stared at her. "It isn't the first time." He tilted his head.
"It's silly to make a fuss."
"A fuss? I'm making a fuss? What are you doing, Sal?"
"I want to fuck you."
She could feel her heartbeat in her mouth.
"No one will know."
Her stomach turned.
"Mr. Rubin wants his check, chica,"
Enrique said from behind her. She turned. "What?" Enrique grinned at her.
"Mr. Rubin, he wants to pay and leave you a buku tip because you are the pinnacle of waitress in all of New Jersey. Yes?"
She didn't tell anyone. She didn't go to work for 4 days, feigning a sinus infection. She took a lot of showers. She spent hours in a pew at Sacred Heart Cathedral.
"Are you all right, Lucinda?"
Reverend Father asked, cornering her in the parking lot by her car. "I'm okay, Father."
"Contemplating the sad state of the world, are we?"
he said with a wry smile. She didn't answer.
"You can always talk to me about things, Lucinda. You know that, okay?"
"Oh, sure, Father," she thought. "You see, Salvatore wants to fuck me, and I'm not sure what to do because, you know, he's Sorrentino's nephew, and I'm sure it wouldn't sit well with Etta and Bruno, or Sal's wife. But what if they don't believe me? So I've been hitting restaurants all over the hood with my resume, but it's hard to find a job close to Maria's school and to my dad and all. So what's your advice, Father?" She read Maria a lot of stories. She ate a lot of cheesecake. She waxed the dining room table countless times. "What's with you and the wax?" Angie said. They had something for her at Costello's, but it was just lunches. And they had something for her at the corner diner, but you needed a place with a bar if you wanted big tips, and the best drink in the diner was a chocolate shake. She worked Thanksgiving. She worked Christmas. She worked in between. She had to. The neighborhood celebrated the holidays big time, and Sorrentino's was packed. Big tabs, big tips. The restaurant had a big tree in the front entrance, wrapped empty boxes under the tree, colored lights that flashed on and off strong behind the bar, the works. She stayed away from him. She didn't put herself anywhere near him. He didn't look at her. She didn't look at him. Maybe it would be okay. Maybe it was over. Maybe she had made it up. And then 2 days after Christmas, when they closed the restaurant so the whole staff could have their big family dinner, and she was there with her dad and Maria and Angie, because how could she tell her family that they weren't going to the family dinner? And there he was with his wife and their 3-year-old Gio and their 7-year-old Anthony, telling stories and being charming, and she thought, okay, this is good, it's over. And on her way back from the ladies' room, he slammed her up against the wall, sliding his wet mouth across her face and eyes, panting,
"I eat you up, Lucinda,"
shoving his meaty hand up her skirt, and she stomped the high heel of her shoe into his instep.
"Everything good at the restaurant?" her father asked.
"Mm-hmm." She'd quit. She'd go in this afternoon and tell them. She'd go into the city and find a goddamn job.
"Did you bring me my lasagna?"
"You saw me, Dad, when I got here."
"Right."
Her father tilted his head towards Mrs. Moskowitz, who was across the room. She was head to toe in powder blue, including a piece of tulle wound around her head, with a matching piece of tulle wrapped around her walker.
"She wanted me to dance with her,"
Nick Conte said in an irritated whisper.
"Does that beat all?"
"What?" Lucinda followed his gaze to Mrs. Moskowitz, who noticed they were looking at her. She lifted one hand off the walker and gave her father a jaunty wave and a toothy smile.
I told her maybe 83 times I'm married. What the hell would your mother say?
Nothing, Dad, Lucinda thought. She's probably having a pina colada on Vinny's boat. Oh, for Christ's sakes. Her eyes filled. She couldn't help it. Dad, do you remember Salvatore?
Who?
Oh, Jesus.
Salvatore who?
He asked, frowning. What the hell was she doing?
Lucinda?
Nobody, really. I was just...
What the hell is going on?
She took a breath. Nothing. I'm sorry, He gave her the stare he gave her when she was 16, and he'd caught her sneaking through the kitchen after midnight due to the fact she'd been kissing John Turner in his car two doors down the street. His eyes narrowed.
He's the construction guy, right?
Daddy, please.
God damn it, Lucinda. Salvatore my ass. What is it? Plumbing? Electrical? Those sons of bitches will take me for all I got. God damn it!
He yelled, standing up fast, nearly losing his balance. Lucinda shot up, grabbed his arm before he fell. He shrugged out of her grasp, straightened his shirt, and ran his hand through his hair.
You tell that son of a bitch Salvatore to call me. I want to know when my house will be ready. You hear me, Lucinda? You tell him I'm the one who pays the goddamn bills.
She called Jose. She met him at Dickie D's and watched him eat a hot dog pushed into pizza dough with onions and peppers. It took a half hour to get him to even look her in the eyes after she told him. You believe me?
It is complicated.
Jose, he shook his head.
You cannot quit without another job.
I'll go to Etta and Bruno.
Nothing will happen.
They'll talk to him. He laughed. The onions and peppers had left their red-orange grease stain around his mouth. He dabbed paper napkins into a cup of water and wiped at his lips.
We will watch you.
What do you mean?
Enrique and Chuchu and Simon and me. Even Carlos, we will watch you. Be next to you.
Etta and Bruno will talk to him.
No.
No?
No, he said. And they will be angry.
At me?
He is their family.
She inhaled. They will be angry? She hadn't been this angry since Marty up and died. Jose, he is a scumbag. Un hijo de puta. Basura. Jose visibly flinched. I'm sorry, she said. I know you don't say those things. Jose, please. He put his hand gently on her arm.
We will watch you.
You will watch me, Lucinda repeated, and felt the air rush out of her body.
Like we watched Rosa.
She lifted her head. Like you watched Rosa, she repeated. Me too, my ass, Rosa said softly, taking a sip of her martini, extending her glass towards Lucinda.
And you can be me three, Cookie.
She put the glass gently back down on the bar and smoothed her skirt under her legs.
So I see those bitches on TV, you know, those actresses, puta movie stars in their black dresses and their sincere eyes, and I listen to how they're going to change the world and bring this sexual harassment thing right to the forefront, you know? Like there won't always be some guy trying to get into your pants, and I laugh, I gotta tell you, while I'm trying to get a grip on the fact that after 17 years at Sorrentino's, those sons of bitches fired me. I go to Etta and Bruno says to me, leave your apron. And I think, fuck you, old man. I should take this apron and cut it into little pieces and shove them up your ass, because I ask you, where are we gonna go? Is there a human resources department at Sorrentino's? Are they gonna lock up Salvatore? Ha ha ha. Another girl gets her tit grabbed in Newark. Call the media. Get that chick a black dress, put her on the Golden Globes.
Golden Globes.
Okay, she sighed. Do you wanna eat something?
Sure, Lucinda said. They make a really good fried calamari here, Rosa said. As good as Chuchu's, she said, lifting her hand and holding her fingers tight against her lips as tears softly covered her face. I promise, she said and laughed. I've gained like maybe 12 pounds. You wouldn't know it. You look great. Rosa cleared her throat and dabbed at the skin under her eyes with the cocktail napkin. So you want that? Calamari? Absolutely, Lucinda said.
She waved her hand at the bartender.
My husband wanted to kill him. I said, oh, that's good, Jack. Then the girls and I can come visit you in prison.
Wonderful. She folded and refolded the little damp napkin. Her hands were shaking.
You have a daughter, right?
She's 6, Lucinda said.
I have 2, 12 and 15.
She shook her head.
Don't ask. She smiled at Lucinda. We should have had boys, huh?
Lucinda smiled back. Jesus.
Before me, he got Denise, Rosa said. Did you know Denise?
No, I didn't know Denise.
She could do 6 tables of 8 without blinking.
Rosa took a breath.
Great waitress, really. She taught me lots of stuff.
She lifted her glass and took another sip.
He hurt her, she said in a whisper. He got her bad in the hallway.
She put the glass down.
We could have prosciutto and melon with the calamari, she said. Would you like that?
Okay, Lucinda answered. She didn't fall off the stool. She moved her icy glass off the bar. The stem left a perfect wet ring. They watched her, especially Enrique, as if he were guarding Shakira while she was on tour. She was never alone with Sal. Never. One of them even waited in the hall when she went to the ladies' room. They never discussed it. Whatever Jose had said to them was enough. And she was calmer. She actually forgot about it every now and then. And when she came to the restaurant with her family on Sundays, because Angie made a big stink when she suggested they go somewhere else.
What do you mean, go somewhere else? Where would we go?
Looking at her like she'd lost her mind. If he walked through the dining room while they were there, you couldn't possibly imagine he was the man who would do such things, shaking her father's hand, giving Angie the right amount of sweet attention. And when he spoke to Maria, he bent down so he was on her level. He even bought her a book about bugs. She'd been fascinated with creepy crawly things since she was maybe 8 months old and saw her first roly-poly bug on the porch. Valentine's Day. It seemed like all of New Jersey wanted to be at Sorrentino's for Valentine's Day dinner. They had stopped taking reservations weeks before. You probably couldn't get in, even if you were Al Rubin. Jose and Marco and Tino were swapping out all the white linens for red. There were red roses going on the tables, red sauce, red velvet cake in the red booths. She was surprised they weren't making the pasta red, thank you, Jesus. And the waitstaff was going to wear red ties instead of black, which Lucinda thought was truly tacky and totally hysterical. Marty had been the one who went overboard for Valentine's Day. He had actually cut hearts out of red construction paper and thrown them all over the bed and her.
These are itchy,
she said to him, paper hearts crackling under her naked butt.
Shut up, Lucinda,
he said, laughing. A damp red heart stuck to his chin. They were ready. Everything was humming. Anything that could be cooked ahead of time was cooked. The water was boiling. The garlic was chopped. The tomatoes, the basil, the parsley. The heavenly smell of bolognese floated from the parking lot out back to the pink neon sign in front. Jose and Marco and Tino were bustling dishes and serving pieces to the tables. Simon was stepping in and out of the building to catch a cigarette. Choo-choo and Carlos were pulling fillets out of the big freezer. Tino was walking around on his cell phone, having a fight with his wife about when his mother-in-law was finally leaving, and Lucinda was coming back from the ladies' room, pulling a stray piece of hair back into her ponytail for maybe the 6th time when she realized Salvatore was at the stove. There was no one else in the kitchen. He was watching her. She froze. He smiled. He had a kitchen towel in his left hand and was reaching for the giant sauté pan behind the huge pots of water. He didn't take his eyes off her. She couldn't make her legs move. The smile became a grin. He put his right hand on the front of his pants and rubbed himself.
I fuck you, Lucinda,
he said in nearly a whisper. A corner of the towel dipped into the fire under the pot. The flames leaped from his cuff up his shirt sleeve. He yelled and jerked his arm back, and his fingers caught the handle of the enormous pot of boiling water that tipped and fell down the front of him, scalding his hand and his pants and his everything. He screamed and fell. Doors flew open. Carlos and Choo-Choo were running. Jose was shouting, but Lucinda didn't move. She just stood there, her hand covering her mouth.
And then she smiled.
The Eve of Infamy by Jim Fusilli. The judge gave Billy Malone a choice. An 18-month stretch in a state prison or the army. Malone saw the offer as the light of good fortune. His play was drying up, and his sinewy, green-eyed charm only went so far. He was thinking he needed a change. It was coming up on 1941, and the Marks had gotten wise. No one in the Bronx, Brooklyn, or Manhattan would sit at a poker table with him, so he was reduced to taking down half-wit tourists. On top of that, the precinct cops were aware of his violent record as a juvenile, so they were keeping a hard eye on him. They pounced when Billy Malone shattered the jaw of an auto parts salesman from Akron, who accused him of marking the deck with a thumbnail. Army, Billy Malone told Judge Stiegel in open court.
I understand you are something of a card sharp, said the judge, who, to Billy Malone, looked like a walrus.
Wherever you go, let it be known. Yes, Your Honor, said Billy Malone, a man of few words. He had gotten what he wanted. Why agitate? He figured the army would give him a free shot at the wide, wide world, a place littered with rubes. Malone was stationed in Fort Irwin, out in the California desert, north of Barstow and about 150 miles from the nightlife in L.A. He figured his luck had run out, the sandstorm stinging his face, his throat parched from first call until he collapsed in his bunk. A 20-mile run under the scorching sun was a punishment far worse than prison back east. He heard Los Angeles calling. After a while, he thought he'd go AWOL and lose himself in the big city. Slinging rocks or scrubbing a latrine, he dreamed of a place he'd only seen in the movies. The clubs, the broads, the action, all accompanied by palm trees and orange groves and the cool breeze off the Pacific. He heard the pounding of foamy waves, the seagull's caw. Fuck this, he thought, broiling in the sun, his blonde hair trimmed to bristle. I'm gone. Then his unit learned they were shipping out to Oahu. Suddenly, Billy Malone took to army life. What the fuck? Do what the screaming sergeant tells you to do. Hump, dive, crawl, climb, shoot, stab. A piece of cake and a climate out of Eden. Free room and board. Lie in the bunk and read the magazines as the scent of ginger and hibiscus wafted into the barracks. Listen to the wind humming through the trees. On and off the base, the poker action was pitiable. It was theft. He had to bite his cheek to tamp down a smirk. He hung back, but within months he'd cleaned out every man in the barracks, including a Corporal Malone sized up as weak. Next game, Malone threw him cards and the petty prick went to his rack up $600. A 3-day pass ensued. The club was less than 2 miles from the base. The first night, Malone, in his floral shirt, ran through a December downpour and played the Filipino card shark straight. He managed to leave up a sawbuck and a half, more than enough for a taxi back to bed. Next night, he won $440 when a rubber trader from Guam dealt him a third jack on the night's last hand. The hat check girl took him home. Her name was Leilani. They spent the next day together, too. She knew a secret cove. Someone had been there before. Melted candles, discarded rum bottles. She lit the wicks and tossed the empties. Afterwards, she walked naked toward the sunlight at the cove's edge. She returned with a small onyx pipe and a bowl of hashish. He waved her off. He had plans, he told her. He was about to play for real dough. She nodded discreetly when Malone came back to the club. A man sat near him at the bar. A conversation began, the man careful not to come on strong. Malone knew what he was up to, this Hawaiian glad hand, this bullfrog-looking fuck. Malone flashed his bankroll to pay for his drink. The man said no, on the house, and invited him to a private room. Bigger stakes.
Saturday night brings in the chumps, he confided.
By midnight, Malone was at the table with a businessman from China. Two GIs in blousy civilian clothes, one from Texas, the other was a skinny guy from the deep south, and a Hawaiian, bloated, full of himself. The GIs counted their money before they anteed up. The Hawaiian, who hassled the hapless help, threw down bills like he owned a mint. Deep South beamed goofy when he won, and Hawaiian stared at him with disdain. Malone looked ahead. He'd sit by while Hawaiian slow-played Deep South into poverty. The frog-faced brush had set up the GIs and the Chinaman. Malone figured he'd been set up, too. He had wondered why the rubber trader from Guam threw him the third jack last night, but now he knew. He was there to fatten the pot. Soon the Chinaman was drained, and Texas went in search of a back-alley blowjob. Eight hands in, the Hawaiian showed strong with two kings, but Deep South, who was dealing, raised and re-raised. The Hawaiian called with a boat, kings over sevens. Deep South had four nines. He giggled as he raked in $1,700. The Hawaiian sat stunned, his mouth flapped open. You wanna keep on, soldier? Deep South asked Billy Malone after the Hawaiian limped away. Malone said, why not? He had till dawn. Deep South dropped his elbows on the table and leaned in with his long, lanky frame. What do you say to 5-card draw? Plain and simple. Fine by me, Malone said. He was surprised the Hawaiian had been gutted. Deep South mucked up the house's scam. Deep South, who blew into the palm of his left hand when he was bluffing. They played even for a while, back and forth. Billy Malone busted up a full house he dealt himself just to see if Deep South was paying attention. Leilani swung by with cocktails, but Malone waved her off. Deep South did too. 40 minutes in, Deep South raised after dealing himself 3 fresh cards. Then he blew into his hand. Malone had taken 2. He already had 3 queens. He re-raised, pushing in his last $1,200. Deep South called. Malone showed the ladies. Deep South turned over 4 sevens, 1 at a time. Out $2,600, Malone stood. He dusted his slacks, slipped back into his jacket. Deep South laughed, his Adam's apple bobbing, as he stacked the cash. Malone pulled himself together and left the back room. The staff was sweeping the floor, chairs were up on the tables. As he walked towards the exit, the lights turned off. Beaten down, he left. Fuck it, thought Billy Malone as he went along through darkness, palm trees quiet against the crescent moon. Deep South took him down square with the false tell. A legitimate play. As payback, he could take his rival's left thumb or crush his mocking Adam's apple. But no. Malone would build up another bankroll and locate another game. A lesson learned. Valuable. In the long run, he'd profit from it. He decided he'd go back to retrieve the girl, grab a bottle and head to the cove. One last good time before he was due at the base. The club's front door was locked. Malone went around back to the screen door to the kitchen. He entered, past hanging pots and pans, and there at the bar was everybody but the Chinaman, the rubber salesman from Guam, the Hawaiian who took the beat, and the 2 GIs, Texas and Deep South. They were divvying the pot. The Hawaiian bullfrog came over to pocket his cut. So did Leilani. They moved quickly, efficiently. All business. Good night.
Next week? Asked the bullfrog.
You bet, said Deep South. It was easy money. The island full of marks from all over the mainland. Sunday dawn was maybe an hour off. Malone hid in the parking lot. The remaining cars were settled close to each other. Malone took off his belt. He figured Texas was carrying, Deep South under his protection. Malone swung the belt and caught Texas in the face with the buckle. Stung, Texas stumbled. Malone kicked his feet out from under him and grabbed the pistol from the GI's waistband. He put the nozzle against the man's sternum and pulled the trigger. On one knee, he turned and shot Deep South in the forehead. In less than a minute, he had the cash and their wallets. He ripped the keys out of Texas's pocket and drove off toward the cove, where he and Leilani had spent the afternoon. He'd wait for the rest of them to come. A couple of weeks in the brig for missing curfew would be worth the taste of revenge. He settled in a crevice, back to the wall, gun drawn. Then came the first of more than 300 Jap bombers. Malone heard the earth-rattling explosions. He moved deeper into the cold cave. In the next horrific hours, hundreds of U.S. military personnel were slaughtered. When the raid ended and an eerie tranquility took hold, Malone drove back to the base. In the distance, the island burned, black smoke billowed, and the scent of gasoline filled the sky. Dead birds littered the ground. He discovered the base was in shambles. One of the Jap bombers dropped his payload on the barracks where his unit slept. Most of his outfit was killed, maimed, or knocked to their knees. No one remembered Billy Malone had been off site. Malone gave a long moment's thought to laying low and heading out. He'd be listed MIA and could start from zero. No record, no history. He'd go to Los Angeles. It was filled with broads like Leilani, and with marks like the Chinaman. He knew the big game now. With his blonde hair and green eyes, he'd reinvent himself. A Swede, a German who got out before Hitler in the Third Reich, a regular American. He could make it work. No, he decided, knee deep in debris. He'd wait out the war and go back to the Bronx. The streets were in his blood. He knew the rooftops and alleyways. Theft came naturally. Violence did too. If the next few years broke his way, he could bankroll a future, playing steady amid the turmoil. Then he'd go back home a champion. He'd aim high. The cops wouldn't dare touch him. About a week after the attack, everybody on high alert, Billy Malone drove a Jeep to the club where he'd been the mark. War or no, he was still out to punish. But a bomb had leveled the club, too. The fire scorching the surrounding property, incinerating the dead and the living. Bodies had been removed. The charred corpses of automobiles remained. He sent a Christmas card to Judge Stiegel, who had shone on him the light of good fortune. "Thanks for everything," he wrote. He signed it, "Very truly yours, Billy Malone, Pearl Harbor, December 1941. Night Rounds by James Reisner. Dave Blake grasped the doorknob and tried to twist it, but it didn't turn. He nodded in satisfaction. Trammell's hardware store was locked up tight for the night, just like it was supposed to be. Blake moved on down the boardwalk to check the door of the next business. This was his favorite time of day and favorite part of the job of marshal. Night had fallen over Wagon Tongue. Most folks were in their homes and had had their supper. Some had turned in already, while others sat in parlors, reading by lamplight or singing old songs with the family gathered around the piano. The Lucky Cuss, Wagon Tongue's only saloon, was still open. But on a weeknight like this, not many customers would be there, and they wouldn't be in any mood to cause a ruckus. Sam Dorn, who owned the place, would likely call it a night and close up soon. Peace reigned over the settlement, just the way Dave Blake liked it. He'd held down the marshal's job for a little over a year, Wagon Tongue being the latest in a string of towns where he had worn the badge. Some lawmen settled down in one place and stayed there most of their lives. Dave Blake had never been that way. He'd always felt too many restless stirrings after he'd been somewhere for a while. An urge telling him that he needed to get up and go somewhere else. It was hard on his wife, Clarissa, he knew, but he couldn't help it. The job here in Wagon Tongue was one of the easiest he'd had. Outlaws didn't have any interest in a sleepy little cow town like this. The only trouble came when cowboys from the spreads between here and the Prophets rode into town, drank too much busthead at the Lucky Cuss, and got prawdy enough to start fights. Blake always managed to break those up without having to resort to gunplay. He touched his Colt's walnut grips now. Except for target practice, knocking airtights off fence posts, he hadn't fired the gun in 5 years. As tranquil as Wagon Tongue was, that streak was likely to continue. He checked the door of Bennett's saddle shop. Locked. Blake started to move on.
Marshal, is that you?
The voice came from behind him, made him pause and half turn. A man-shaped patch of darkness came along the boardwalk toward him, not really hurrying, but moving along pretty briskly. Blake hadn't recognized the voice, so he said,
Yeah, it's me. Who's there?
Jack Hargis. I ride for the Circle P.
Blake didn't know the name, but that wasn't surprising. Cowhands moved in and out of the area all the time. Roundup would be coming along soon, so the ranchers were taking on extra hands. What can I do for you, Hargis? The man waved a hand in the general direction of the Lucky Cuss, at the other end of town and on the opposite side of the street.
I think some fellas down there are fixing to cause trouble, Marshal. You might want to go read them from the book.
My rounds will take me that way in a few minutes. I'll look in on the place when I get there. I always do. Blake didn't mention that Sam Dorn usually treated him to a short beer. And from there he went on home, where Clarissa would be waiting for him with a late supper. It was a mighty nice way to finish off the day, which was another reason Blake enjoyed making these rounds. He had something to look forward to.
I don't know, Marshal,
Hargis said as he stepped closer.
It looked kind of serious to me. I'm not sure you should wait.
I appreciate you speaking up, but I'll get to it. Blake's tone was a little more impatient.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.